Greetings, Benjamin J. the Victrola Guy. I got an email just a few moments ago from a gentleman that asked if I could do a video on the machine that I'm using for my recordings. I talk about this all the time, but I very rarely show it. This is the Edison Standard B phonograph. Now, when I found this machine, it was an absolute wreck. There was no paint left on the bed plate at all. It was just solid rust. As you can tell, I don't know if you can tell or not, there's no nickel left on the mandrel at all. It's solid brass. And when I got this, the brass or the nickel had actually turned black and I could scrape it off with my thumbnail. And I soaked this in diesel fuel for 24 hours, actually pearl kerosene, to break the wax loose or to break the rust loose. Now, there's a secret on virtually rebuilding any machine. If you find a machine that's in really, really terrible shape, if you can soak it in diesel fuel, which is what I do, because diesel fuel or kerosene gets down into virtually every little nook and cranny and really helps to break these screws loose. If you can get all the screws out, you can rebuild the machine. It's really that simple. And what you need to do is you need to get one of these. This is a little tiny torch. And with this torch, you can heat a tiny, tiny spot on the machine, and you can heat any specific spot without doing any real damage. And a combination of the diesel fuel and applying heat, you can usually get almost any screw out, no matter how badly rusted it is. What you have to be very cautious of, especially with rusted screws, is you'll try to screw them out, and you'll either tear the head off or you'll break the screw off. Now, once you've done that, you are stuck, because then you're going to have to re-drill it and re-tap it. The secret is, if you can get the screws out, you can rebuild the machine. It's really that simple. Now, this machine, as I said, was an absolute wreck. The only thing holding the box together when I got it was the weight of the machine. All the glue had let go, and these were assembled with animal glues, horse glue, and the moisture over the years. And this one had obviously been sitting probably in a damp basement. That's what it looked like. And the problem, of course, is these wooden cabinets soak up moisture like a sponge with this mechanism sitting inside of it, and the rust just eats them alive. And I've resprayed this with satin black Rust-Oleum. It's got about 6 coats of paint on it, and it's very, very close. I don't know how well you can tell in the video, but it's very, very close to the original Edison color. From even a foot away, you would never know this machine had been repainted. And I don't do anything to them to try to restore them. When I got this machine, it was with the intention of using it. I rebuilt it with the intention of using it as a 2-minute recorder, and it works extremely well. I've had to do nothing else to it. Of course, I had to completely disassemble it just to get the rust off of it, break parts loose, clean them as best I could. But I didn't sit here and polish the screws. I just got them functional again, reassembled the machine, and it works extremely well as a 2-minute recorder. And this is the Edison recorder that I'm using. And this is, I found this on eBay. And this is what an Edison recorder looks like. And it's basically a stylus, a sapphire stylus, in a small copper foil stylus holder. And it's glued directly to the diaphragm. And so, as you're recording, this little sapphire stylus is plowing directly into the wax of the cylinder. And remember, this is a vertical recording, so the stylus is vibrating up and down with the movement of the diaphragm. It's very, very simple. And yet you've heard for yourself, the results are actually quite incredible. Now, this did not come when I got it. It did not have a reproducer on it. So obviously I've installed a reproducer, and it also was missing this thumb screw. And most of these Edison screws are very, very odd threads, but here's a great tip. This is actually the speed control from a Victor Victrola. The speed control on the Victor Victrola is exactly the same thread as the reproducer thumb screw on the Edison cylinder phonograph. So I found I had a bunch of Victor parts, and just by chance I picked one up and put it in there, and it was exactly the right thread, so I just cut it off to fit. This one's made of brass, as you can tell. Nice thing about brass is it will never rust. I don't know why they didn't originally use brass, but they didn't. And so if you need a thumb screw for your Edison cylinder phonograph, look on eBay or look through junk parts for Victor machines. And if you find the speed control, you now have a thumb screw for your Edison cylinder phonograph. You cut it off to about 3/4 of an inch and screw it in and you're up and running. So it's fairly simple, and then to install the recorder, you simply loosen the thumb screw, remove the reproducer. Now I've got all mine numbered. Obviously this is number one. I have several Model C reproducers. And then you take your recorder, install it where the reproducer was, make sure it's flush, tighten the thumb screw. The machine's ready to record. Now if you're going to be doing a strict acoustic recording, you can take a simple speaking tube, which is a brass bell on a rubber cloth covered hose. It just slides over the recorder and you begin speaking directly into it, and you get a very, very good recording, surprisingly good. The Caniphonic process is proprietary, so I can't show you or tell you how I'm doing it, not yet in any case. I'm eventually going to be doing a video of what the Caniphonic process is, how it works, and I think you'll be quite surprised. The Caniphonic process is still a completely acoustic process, so I am not putting some kind of electronic recorder on the machine. I'm still using that recorder, recording horns. I'll have to go into it in detail some other time. I can't reveal the constituents of the Caniphonic process yet, but it works. And as I said, I've worked about 8 months on learning to record on the Edison cylinder phonograph. And this is not a special machine by any stretch of the imagination. As I said, I picked this up for $40 simply because the guy who was selling it thought it was useless. Don't overlook the junk machines. I probably said that 1,000 times now. You can see that there's swarf all over this machine. And I just have a small paintbrush. I brush the swarf off, record, brush the swarf off, record, brush the swarf off. And the swarf gets everywhere. I mean, it gets into the motor, into the gears, it gets into the governor, it gets into virtually every moving part. But for a recorder, this has worked really well. It cost almost nothing. I've had an absolute blast. It was a lot of fun to repair this machine and bring it back to life. Now there's one more thing I wanted to point out on the standard B phonograph. A lot of the standards have this and a lot of people don't know it. The machine is supposed to run at 160 RPM, and there's several ways to set the speed on these. The easiest way, of course, is if you noticed on the carriage rod, there's two lines. There's one here and there's one here. When the machine's running at the right speed, it is exactly 1 minute from that mark to that mark. So you simply line up the carriage there, start the machine, drop the carriage, let the feeds crew carry it across. If it gets there quicker than 1 minute, it's running too fast. If it gets there slower than 1 minute, it's running too slow. The second way to set the speed is you can put on a cylinder with a small piece of paper trapped between the cylinder and the mandrel, and then put your finger here and count 10 four times as the paper goes by. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4. 40 revolutions in 15 seconds equals 160 RPM. The other way, of course, is they have a small paper strobe that you can put on the end of the mandrel, and it requires an incandescent light bulb to use it. The easiest way is just a piece of paper and just count the RPM with your finger. Remember, 40 RPMs in 15 seconds is 160, or from that mark on the carriage rod to that mark on the carriage rod is 1 minute. Fairly simple machine. Strictly 2-minute machine, and the reason I wanted to use a standard B for a recorder is it has an end gate. Now I've used the D and I've used the home. The nice thing about having an end gate is the mandrel supported on both ends, and you have a rather simple bearing here. Of course, it's just a pointed hardened steel shaft that goes into a tapered hole. A few drops of oil, drop of oil on the carriage rod itself, a few drops of oil on the mandrel shaft, and of course a few drops of oil on the governor and the friction pads, and this makes a really, really effective little recorder. And I've replaced the belt. As you can see, there's a guy on eBay selling these replacement belts. They're $12, $15 each, You can make your own. I originally was using an O-ring. The nice thing about O-rings is they're 60 cents and they track true. But when I found these belts, I figured, hey, 12 bucks, threw it on there, it works great, no problems, no muss, no fuss. So this is my Edison 2-minute recorder. And as you can see, I have made no attempt whatsoever to restore the machine. I simply painted it to keep it from rusting. I replaced the screws with brass. I have not replaced the Edison signature trademark, the lining on the bed plate, nothing. Original old machine in extremely bad condition when I got it. It took me 3-4 days to get this thing up and running, and I have not had one single problem with it since then. It runs well. It sounds good from a distance of a foot away. If I put the trademark, signature trademark back on it, I don't think anybody would ever know the machine has been refinished or repainted. Still rust on all the screw heads, but for what I wanted to use it for, it works extremely well, and I could not be happier. This machine has caused me no problems at all, and it's allowed me to do some really serious recording on the Edison Cylinder Phonograph. And this is where it all started. As you can tell, I have not even replaced the ID plate. So, as I say, don't overlook the junk machines. I paid $40 for this and spent 5 days repairing it, or actually rebuilding it. 24 hours soaking in diesel fuel, or in this case actually pearl kerosene. Pearl kerosene is charcoal lighter. You can go down and get about a quart bottle of it at Walmart for a few dollars. And just take the bed plate, separate the bed plate from the motor, put the motor in a small plastic container, and just soak it for 24 hours in charcoal lighter, which is just pearl kerosene. And as I said, if the screws are stubborn, use the little torch, apply a pinpoint flame right to that spot. Usually the rust will break free and you can pull the screws out. And that's the secret. If you can get the screws out, you can rebuild the machine. So a $40 Edison machine that is working quite well, and every cylinder recording I have made, with the exception of when I first started, I was using the Edison Standard D. When I became serious about doing some recordings, I went out looking for a Standard B, simply because it has an end gate, and I wanted a machine as a dedicated recorder that had a bearing on both ends of the mandrel. Especially if you're going to be transporting it in any way at all, it's just, for recording, it's much more efficacious to have the mandrel supported on both ends. So in any case, this is my Edison recorder. It was inexpensive. It's fairly simple. It works well, which is the important part. It cost almost nothing, and I've had an absolute blast working with this old machine. This was manufactured in 1903, and this is a straight 2-minute Edison Standard B cylinder phonograph. So in any case, if you have any questions on the Edison phonograph, anything I've covered in my YouTube series, feel free to drop me an email, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. I answer all my email. I try to answer it the day I get it. So this is my dedicated 2-minute recorder, the Edison Standard B phonograph. So if you do have any questions or comments, please feel free to drop me an email, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. And as always, thank you for watching.